Hello everyone, I am Siddharthan. Currently, we are in the 6th module of our hands-on machine learning course, and this 6th module is all about machine learning models. So far in this module, we have discussed what is meant by a machine learning model and how does a machine learning model works, what are the different types of supervised learning and unsupervised learning models that we have in machine learning. And then we have discussed some important issues that we face while training a machine learning model, such as overfitting and underfitting. So in those videos of overfitting and underfitting, I mentioned that bias variance trade-off is something. So it is a technique that we can use in order to rectify this issue of overfitting and underfitting. So in this video, let's try to understand what is meant by this bias variance trade-off and how we can use this particular method in order to prevent overfitting or underfitting. Okay. So this is the agenda of today's video. Before getting started, in case you are watching my videos for the first time, in this YouTube channel, I'm making a hands-on machine learning course. And if you want to learn this course from the beginning, I'll give the link of my course playlist in the description of this video. So you can check that out. With that being said, let's get started with today's video. So before going into bias variance trade-off, we need to understand what is meant by bias and what is meant by variance, okay? So this is the formal definition of bias. Bias is the difference between the average prediction of our model and the correct value which we are trying to predict, okay? So it is the difference between the two values. So what are these two values? The prediction made by our model and the actual value. So let's try to understand this with an example. Let's say that we are making a machine learning model to predict the salary of a person given their experience. Let's say that the person has 4 years of experience and the salary that they are getting currently is about 30,000 rupees per month. And let's say that we are using this experience data, that is the number of years of experience, which is 4 years in this case, and we feed this to our machine learning model. And let's say that our model has predicted that that person earns a salary of about 28,000 rupees per month. Okay, so here in this case, the value predicted by our model is 28,000 and the correct value or actual value is 30,000. So the difference between the two values is 2,000 rupees, right? And this difference between the predicted value and the correct value is called as bias. Okay, so it tells us what is the difference between those two values. So let's try to understand this with this particular curve. So we have some data points. Okay, so this can be the similar example which we took. So let's say that we have the number of years of experience in the x-axis and a salary value in the y-axis, and we are plotting the data. So let's say that this first point represents 1 year of experience. So the corresponding value in x-axis, let's say that it represents 1 year, and the corresponding y-axis value represents maybe 20,000 rupees. So similarly, we have several data points and we need to find a model in order to fit to this particular data. So if you look at this data, we can say that there is a linear relationship between them. So, you know, there is a positive correlation between them. That is, if one value increases, the other value also increases. That is, if the number of years of experience of a person increases, their salary also increases, right? So when you have such kind of relationship between x-axis and y-axis, or the x-values and the y-values, you can fit the data by using a normal straight line. Okay, so what this line signifies is, if you take this particular point, it represents, maybe let's say that this particular point represents 10 years of experience. And if you take the corresponding value, let's say that the salary they are making is about 80,000 rupees. So this is how we, you know, try to understand the data and the model which we are fitting. So this is a straight line, which means there is a linear relationship between them, where if one value increases, the other value also increases. Now, it is impossible to, you know, draw a straight line which touches all these data points. So we try to, you know, build a model that is close to all the data points, right? So, but it is impossible for this particular model to touch all these data points. So you cannot use a straight line for that purpose. You can use a curve which goes through all these data points, but a straight line cannot do that. So there is some distance between these data points and the model, right? So this blue color line is called as the model. So this is an example of a linear model or linear regression. And we know that the equation of a line is y is equal to mx plus c, right? So that is the equation of this particular line. And if we try to find the distance between the data points and the model, we get something like this, okay? So let's let this black color dotted lines represents the distance between the data point and the model, and this particular distance is called as bias. Okay, so now you can read this definition again and it will make you, you know, it will make more sense to you. So bias is nothing but the difference between the data points and the model, the value predicted by the model and the correct value. Okay, now what we are going to do is We are going to change the training data. So here, let's say that we have some set of training data, and now we are changing the training data that we have. So this is one set of data, and this is another set of data. And now we are again trying to use a similar kind of model, a similar kind of straight line, which can fit to this particular data point. And let's say that we are getting a line like this. So in both the cases, the data are different. But you can see here that the line is almost similar. So there can be a slight change in their slope and intercept. So in the equation of a line, y is equal to mx plus c, m is the slope. Okay, so slope, if you change the slope, the orientation of the line will change. And if you change the intercept, this distance will increase. So this distance from this origin 0 to this particular point is called as intercept. So you can compare the intercept of these two lines and the slope of these two lines. So there is not much difference between them. So both of these lines are different, so because we are using different kind of data, but they are almost similar to each other. There is a huge bias in both cases. So there is bias, that is the distance between the data points on the model in this case as well as this case, but there is not much variation to the model, right? So because these two models are very similar to each other, so there is a very less variation between them. So we call this variation as variance. So this particular case has a very small, very high bias and a very low variance. So that is the inference that we are getting. So this is what we will get when we are using a simple model like a straight line. Okay, so just try to understand up to this point. So this is called as bias. And now we are going to understand about variance. So variance is the amount that the estimate of the target function will change if different training data was used. Okay, so let's try to understand this variance. So in this case, the target function or the model will change if your training data changes. But in the previous case, we have seen that there is not much change in the model or the target function. In this case, the target function is a straight line, and in both the cases, they are almost similar. But variance is something where there will be some amount of variation between them. So let's say that we have the same data that we had in the previous case. So the red color data points, and then we will have the other yellow colored data points. So in this case, let's use a more complex model. Okay, so a model, a curve that can pass through all these data points. So you will get a curve like this. So there is not a general trend between them. So there is this curve increases suddenly and then decreases and so on, but it touches all the data points. Okay, and now when you change the data point, if you try to use a similar kind of curve, you won't get a similar curve. You will get a very different kind of curve. And we can say that there is a huge variation between them. So this is called as the variance between them. So variance is nothing but the amount, the estimate of that particular amount of the target function will change. So there is a quite change between them, right? So we are measuring how much is this particular change. And if the change is huge, we call this particular case, it has high variance. Okay, whereas the previous case, both of these models is almost similar, even though we use a different kind of data. But in this case, there was huge bias. But in this particular case, we can say that there is zero bias because the model touches all the data points and there is no distance between the data point and the model. Okay, so when you use a similar model like a straight line, in most of the cases you will have a very high bias, but there won't be any much variance in it. Okay, whereas when you use a more complex model, the bias will be zero, but there will be a huge variance in them. Okay, so that is the one main inference which we need to understand here. Now let's try to understand how this comes into play when we have the problem of overfitting and underfitting, and how we can adjust between the values of bias and variance to overcome this overfitting and underfitting. Let's try to understand this with an example. So we want to identify an appropriate model to predict the height of a person when their weight is given. Okay, so we need to find a suitable model for this purpose, and this model should predict the height of a person when we give their weight. Okay, so this is the case that we have, and we need to analyze this, and we need to find whether we need a simple linear model or we need a more complex curve. Okay, so that's what we are going to do in this particular case. Let's say that this is the data that we have. So we have weight in the x-axis and y, height in the y-axis, and this is the data point that we have. If you want to fit an optimized curve to this particular data, you will get a curve like this. So what this signifies is there is an increase in this curve. Okay, so the curve slightly increases, and there is a slight decrease in the value. Okay, so what this means is when height increases up to a certain point, the height also increases, but after a certain point, even though the weight increases, the height kind of decreases. This means the people are starting to get obese. Okay, so that is the one main inference that we are getting. So increase in, you know, the height of the person, height of different people increases with weight, but after a certain point, there will be no increase in height and they will be tend to, you know, become more obese. So this will be the optimum curve for this particular data point. Now let's try to analyze this with a straight line and a more complex curve and see how this leads to overfitting and underfitting. Now let's plot on training data. So we are taking one set of data, and this is what happens when you do underfitting, and this is the case when it, you know, overfit. So underfitting is something where your model tends to generalize the data. Okay, so if you fit this particular data point with a straight line, it means whatever may be the case, if the weight of a person is more, their height will be more. So if the weight increases, the height also increases. But this is a very wrong inference or a wrong insight, because we discussed that after a certain point, even though the weight increases, the height doesn't increase. So this is a wrong statement or wrong insight when we use a linear model. And this is how a overfitted model looks like. So this particular case is called as underfitting, because the model has underfitted the data. It doesn't find the pattern present in the data. The pattern is nothing but the weight should the height should increase and then it should decrease. Now when you overfit the data, the model tries to fit to all the data points and you won't get a generalized trend. Okay, so again, there is no trend in this. Here there is an increasing trend, but in this case there is no trend. So there is a slight increase and then there is a decrease and so on. So this particular case is called as overfitting. Now we need to understand what is the bias and variance when it comes to underfitting and what is the bias and variance for overfitting. Okay, so now let's try to change the training data again as we have did before. So I'm changing the training data, and this is the overfitting and underfitting that I get. So this is the underfitting, and we know that when we are using a straight line or when we are using an underfitted model, there will be a high bias, but there won't be any variation between them. So this particular model is very similar to this particular model. Okay, so they both are almost similar. But in the case of a overfitted model, when you use a very complex model, the variation between the model will change if you change the data, training data. So these are the different data. So the red colored circles represented a different data and yellow color circle represented a different data. So in this case, what we are understanding is when we are using underfitted model, we are getting a very high bias but a very low variance because there is no change in the model. But when we are using a overfitted model, more complex model, we are getting overfitting, and in this case the bias is less but the variation is very high. So we can say that whenever we are dealing with underfitting, there will be a very high bias and low variance, and in the case of overfitting, there will be low bias and high variance. And this is the important insight we are getting. So what is a good model in this case? A good model is something which does not underfit and which does not overfit. So it should be in the middle part, and we call that as an optimized model. Okay, so we doesn't want our model to underfit or overfit, and it should be in the middle. So it should be an optimized model. How we can do this is by adjusting the values of bias and variance. Okay, so if you have a median value of this bias and variance, then we would get an optimized model. Okay, so this particular curve represents this in a better way. So this red color curve represents the variance value. So this this particular point represents low variance, and this point represents high variance, and this represents low bias, and this particular blue color line represents high bias. And now we have the error value here. Okay, so in this case you can see here the error value is very less in this particular point, right? So this is the most optimized complexity of the model. So if you take a straight line, the complexity of a straight line is very less, so we can say that it is somewhere here. And if you use a more complex curve, if you use a curve which has some ups and downs in it, then the complexity of the model is more. So whenever you are using a very less complex model, you will have a very high bias, but the variance won't be that much high. And whenever you are using a more complex model, the bias will be very less and the variance will be very more. You know, this is nothing but what we have discussed in the previous two slides. So as we have discussed that in the case of overfitting, so overfitting is like when you use a more complex model, like a curve which increases or decreases. So in that case, we realize that the bias will be less and the variance will be more. And this is in the case of underfitting. So this particular part represents underfitting and this particular part represents overfitting. And this is the more optimized part where we have an optimized value or almost not I value of both bias and variance. So there is some significant values, but both of these values are not too much and they are not too less. So we want something like this. So this is the optimized part and we want our model to have something like this. So this is called as bias variance trade-off, to trade off the values of bias and variance to get an optimized model. Okay, so there are some techniques that we can use in order to get this proper bias variance trade-off. Okay, so one thing which you can do is a good model selection. So as we have discussed before, when you use a very simple model, it will lead to the problem of underfitting, and when you use a very complex model, it will lead to the problem of overfitting. So good model selection is a very important thing which we need to do to rectify this. So for a complex problem where there is no linear relationship, we may use a complex model, but when the relationship is linear, we can use a simple linear model and something like that. So you need to understand the data first. You need to understand what is the relationship between the various features in that particular data. And then you need to select your model based on that. You cannot use a single model in all the cases. So that's one main thing which we need to understand here. So when you use a proper model, then you will have a proper values of bias and variance. And the other method which you can use is regularization. So this particular regularization is very helpful in order to prevent overfitting. So regularization tries to reduce the values of coefficient. Let's say that we have a polynomial model. So this is an example of a polynomial model. So this red color curve represents the model or the curve, and the equation for this particular model is this y is equal to b naught plus b1 x1 plus b2 x1 squared. Here x1 represents the feature. Let's say that x1 represents the years of experience of a person, and y is the salary they can get, and b naught, b1, b2 are the parameters of this particular model. When you use the methods of regularization, so there are different kinds of regularization methods which we will discuss later. So when you do those regularization, it tries to reduce the values of these coefficients, this b0, b1 and b2, etc. So when you try to reduce the values of these coefficients, the model will be more simple. So the complexity of the model will be reduced and your model won't overfit. So that is the process of regularization. And the third thing which you can do is dimensionality reduction. So dimension is nothing but the features that we have in our data. Let's say that in our data we have thousands of features, and if you have a very large number of features, then we say that it has a very huge dimension. So having a high number of dimension will create a more complex model. So we need to reduce this dimension. For this we use several techniques such as principal component analysis and something like that in order to find which parameters or which features are very important for us. And there is also another thing called as feature selection, where we try to select the more important features that we need for a particular problem. So when you do these kind of optimization techniques and data processing techniques, you will have a less complex model, and this will lead to a better bias variance trade-off. And then you can use ensemble methods. So if your model is underfitting, you can use ensemble method. So ensemble is something where we use two or three models together in order to get a better prediction. Okay, so you may use multiple models together, and this is called as ensemble. So these are some techniques which you can use in order to implement this bias variance trade-off. So this particular module will be theoretical and conceptual. So we will be dealing about all these things in an hands-on session later in Python. So I will be making a separate module on model optimization later, and in that particular module I'll explain you in detail in a hands-on session in Python on how to implement all these techniques. Okay, so that's it about bias variance trade-off and how you can implement bias variance trade-off, and I hope you have understood all the things covered in this video. So that's it for this video, and I'll see you in the next upload. Thanks for watching.